Hello students, we are going to study about the lecture number. In this lecture number 2, first of all we are going to see the formal definitions, or we are going to consider the summary that we have discussed in the previous lecture. If I discuss and describe the summary, then what we have discussed, we have seen that formally we are having given a relation R, we denoted by the capital letter, with the attributes, the set of attributes written in the small braces. Now if we are having this small r which is being formed from the capital R, it denotes that relation state is the subset of the domains of attributes of Cartesian product. That means what we can say, that if we are having this as the relation given to us, in this we can say that capital R along with the set of attribute is the schema of the relation. So this is the schema, this is the schema of the relation, where R is the name of the relation and A1, A2 are the attributes of the relation, which is being framed and made by taking any relation state. So this relation state denoted by small r with the capital letter R in the braces specifies a specific state or the value or population of relation R, and it is being actually the set of tuples or the rows. So what we can say, that any specific relation state is the collection of tuples. It is being formed by the collection of tuples. And what is the tuple? The tuple are the collection of values. So every tuple is having a value that is being specified on the basis of the domain of the respective. Now if I say about example, if I take a simple example to describe the concept of formal definition, we are having the capital R with A1 and A2 as a relation schema. Now if we are having the two relation, that means every attribute is having the domain. We are having the two attributes, that is A1 and A2. So every attribute will having its domain. Now for example, I say that the domain of A1 is 0 and 1, while the domain of A2 is ABC. Then the domain of A1 into domain of A2 is all possible combination. That means if I take the ordered pair or Cartesian product for the ordered pair of these two domains, then I will having the respective combination. That means it is being formed from 0A, 0B, 0C, 1A, 1B and 1C. So this is the possible combination that denotes the Cartesian product of the two domains. Now the relation state R, what does the relation state R says in the previous slide? That the relation state R is a subset of the domains of attributes Cartesian product. So we are having the two attribute, and the domain of attribute A1 along with the domain of attribute A2's Cartesian product is a subset of the relation state. So for example, if small r or relation state could be 0A, 0B or 1C, we are having these as the ordered pair. If I take at random any pair of ordered pair, then this could be the relation state. This is one possible state of the relation R defined over A1 and A2. So it has three tuples, that is 0A, 0B and 1C. So it is being formed by the three tuples with the two value in every tuple. Now in short, if I say and define the summary of the relation or the concepts or the things that we have taken and studied up till, what we are having? We are having this table that completely defines the summary and compares the formal and the informal terms. For example, we are saying a relation as a table in an informal manner. Actually, it is a table, but when we discuss and describe the terms in relation with the relational model, then it is actually defining a relation. The column header of the table is actually the attribute's name, while all possible column value comprises of the domain. Row denotes the tuple, and the table definition denotes the schema of relation. So what is the table? Framed table is being formed, or table is defining the schema of a relation, while the populated table actually is the state of the. Now if I take the example of a relation student that we have discussed in the previous lecture also, we are having this as the student. This is the name of the relation. The student is being formed as a relation, that is it is a table. Now we know that table comprises of the rows and the column, but it is an informal name. In a formal manner, we called it as the relation comprising of the attributes and the tuple. So what is attribute? Attribute is the column header and tuples are the rows. and every row is having the value. So for example, if I say this as the attribute, how many attributes are there? We are having the 6, 7 attribute, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, and every 7 attribute is having the 5 rows, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and every row is being made up of these 7 values. So if I say about T1 is having how many values? V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6 and V7. Similarly, every tuple, 5 tuple is being made up of by the values of V1 to V7. And these values are actually being made on the basis of the domain of the attribute. So this is the complete example of the student relation. Now if I say about the characteristics of relation, we have seen about the ingredients that are being needed to study on to make the table, that is whether it is tuple, whether it is domain, whether it is attribute, whether it is the relation itself or the relation state. Now there are certain other things that are also being needed to study the relation, that is the characteristics of relation. The first characteristic defines that ordering of tuples in a relation. That means the tuples are not considered to be ordered even though they appear to be in tabular form. So the first characteristic says that if we are having any relation and we know that the relation comprises of the tuples, now if the tuples are not ordered, then it is okay, the relation is not going to be disturbed. So the first characteristic says that ordering of tuple in a relation is not considered to be ordered. Now if I say about the relation that we have discussed up till now, that is the student, you can see that this table comprises of the 5 tuples and we are having the 7 attributes. Now if you see about the different types of values that are being present in these tuples, so every tuple is having the 7 respective values. But if I say that Dick Davidson come here, that means the tuple number 1 is being interchanged with the tuple number 5. That means all the values of these tuples will come here and all the values of this tuple will come here. Similarly, if I change the Barbara with the Benjamin or Rohan with the Dick, that means the rows are going to be changed, but their internal values are not going to be changed. So we can say that the first point itself describes about this. That is, the ordering of tuples in a relation is not considered, while the ordering of attributes in a relation schema defines that we will consider the attributes in relation and the values in tuple. So the second point says that tuple ordering is not at all being considered as a simple point or a characteristic, but the values of the tuples should not be disturbed. That means whatever be the tuple is being formed, the values should always be ordered. So for example, if we are having this as the relation and I am saying that we are having these 5 tuples which are being made up of 7 values. For example, if I am having the tuple number 1 with value 1 as Dick Davidson. If I write this value in the age and the value of age in the Dick Davidson, is it a right way to define the tuples? That means the tuples values or the order of the values has been changed. It is changing the syntax of the relation. So that is not at all being permitted. And this is the second characteristic that defines this. So if you say about the ordering of attributes in a relation schema R, what does it say? It says that the tuples values must be in a proper order. Although the tuples can change the order, but their respective values should not change their order. Now the third characteristic says the values in a tuple. All values are considered atomic. You can see that every value of a tuple is atomic. It is independent. It is not being related or associated with anything. Only the value means, for example, in the table, the Dick Davidson is a 1 value of tuple 1. It is, second one is Barbara Benson. That means Dick Davidson and Barbara Benson are the name of person, and every value of this T1, T2, T3, T4, T5 denotes that these are unique, independent. They don't have any association or relation. It is denoting one independent and the atomic value. So this is the third characteristics of the relation. Similarly, it says each value in tuple must be from the domain of the attribute for that column. So we know that if the tuple is comprising of the values V1 to Vn and it is the relation state, then V1 must be having a domain. So for example, if I say that the range of this age is from 18 to 28. So this is the range of the age. So every tuple that is denoting the value for age will take the values from 18 to 25. That means the domain of this attribute is specifying the range of age from 18 to 28, and it is the specification that is being followed by every tuple's value. So this is the third characteristic. Now there is one important point to note, that a special null value is used to represent values that are unknown or inapplicable to certain tuples. We are having null value that can be used to represent values that is either unknown or the value of the tuples that is not at all clear. So these are the certain characteristics of the. Now there is one important point, that how we are going to define the component values of tuple. For example, tuple is always being formed from the attribute, and tuple is itself containing the values. So we can write the association between the tuple and attribute as ta1 in this manner, or t.a1, where vi of attribute ai for the tuple t, whatever be the value for that tuple is having, it is actually being framed and denoted for the respective attribute ai. So this is the simple notation that is being needed to denote the relations with their respective attributes and their respective. Now we are having another point of interest to note, is the relational integrity constraint. Up till now we have discussed about the introduction for the relational model, in which we have seen about the various things, that what is the tuples, what is the values, what is the attribute, what is the domain, what is the relational schema, what is the relation state. Now the next important point of interest is the relational integrity constraint. In this we are going to see that constraints are certain conditions or restrictions that must be valid whenever there is a relation state. So if we are having the relation and we are taking the relation state, then these constraints must always be satisfied. We are having the three main types of constraints in the relational model, that is the key constraint, entity integrity constraint, referential integrity constraint. And there is certain another type of constraint that is also valid, that is the domain constraint. That means every value in the tuple must be from a domain of attribute, therefore it is called as the domain constraint. But majorly we are having these three different types of constraints only, that is key, entity and the referential. Now we are going to see these constraints one by one. The first is the key constraint. Key constraint, first of all, what does the key constraint is being defining? First of all, we are having a super key of relation. Super key means, super key is a set of attributes denoted by SK of R for relation with the following condition. So when we say about the super key of a relation, that means we are having a set of attribute SK of R with the following condition. The conditions is, no two tuples in any valid relation state R will have the same value for SK. So if we are having no two tuples, we are having tuples that is having a valid relation state R will have the same value. And how it will have the same value? When we are having this condition that is going to be valid. That means the tuple 1's super key should be different from the tuple t2 super key. Both the tuples must not have the same value. This condition must hold in any valid state R. So this is the definition of a super key. What does the super key says? That this is a constraint. Super key means that there must not be any two tuples which are having the same values. If that is having the same value, that means it is not having the super key condition. So super key means whenever there is a super key, that means there must be any two different tuples having the different values. They must not have the same value. This is the condition for the super key. Now when we say about the another term, that is the key, what happened? It is a minimal super key. How it is a minimal super key? See, we have taken the key as a super key K, such that removal of any attribute from K result in a set of attribute that is not a super key. That means if we are having the set of attribute and we have taken the set of attribute forming the super key, now the remaining attributes that are not the part of the super key will actually be act as a key. So we can say the key is a minimal super key. Now if we see the concept in a more descriptive manner, we are having an example. What happened? It is a car relational schema with the respective attributes like this. Now if you see, the car has the two key. The key one comprises of the state and registration number, while the key two comprises of the serial number. But both are also the super keys of the car. They are not alone the key, they are also the super key. Why it is a super key? Since key is always being formed from the super key. So super key will always be there, since key is only the part of the super key and the key is formed from the super key. But super key is not formed from the key. Therefore, the serial number make is a super key but not a key. So in general, we can say any key is a super key, but super key is not a key. And any set of attribute that include in a key is a super key. So key and the attributes of the key must be a part of the super key. But super key cannot be a key. That is also a condition. So minimal super key is a key. Now there is another term related with this keys also, that if a relation has several candidate key, one is chosen to be the primary key. Now if we are having another type of key, that is the candidate key, and it is having various types of attribute that are forming the candidate key. Now what we will do to discriminate, to having a discrimination regarding the various types of attribute forming the candidate key, is that we will take one attribute as a primary key and we will make it underlined. So the attribute which is forming the primary key is underlined. Now for example, again we discuss the car relation schema. In car we are having these six different types of attribute in which the serial number is acting as a primary key since we have underlined it. So out of different types of key, if any attribute is underlined, then it is acting as a primary key. So what does the primary key denote? Primary key is used to uniquely identify each tuple in a relation. That means it provides the tuple identity. Also used to reference the tuple from another tuple. We are having the two tuples, and if we are interested to reference it, then this is being acted and provided by the primary key. So generally we always try to prefer the primary key as the smallest key of the candidate key. Now if we see the concept that we have discussed just right now with the two candidate key, that is the license number chosen as the primary key. You can see this is the diagram, this is the figure that clearly says that car relation has two candidate key, license number and engine serial number. Out of these two keys, we have chosen license number as a primary key, and this is the description since it is being under. So this is all about the lecture number 2. Thank you.